So welcome to the show. We are here today with the all-powerful Ill Factor, this incredible producer that you need to know more about. He is also the founder of Beat Academy Online, which you should definitely check out. Hello.
Hey, what's going on? Thank you so much for having me here.
So you were just telling me about how you were able to go to the Grammys with Modest Yahoo.
Yeah, so I was nominated for a Grammy off of that album. Faye was nominated for Best Reggae Album, and I wasn't at all aware that like I would be able to go to the Grammys for a reggae album.
Yeah.
And I was like, that wasn't my intention. But that whole project in itself was really cool because I had no idea. My manager at the time was like, oh, I need you to fly to New York. Got this this white rapper that I want you to work with. His name's Modest Yahoo. I'm like, that's the weirdest rapper name I've ever heard of.
Yeah.
So I'm making all these crazy like street, like this guy, if he's gonna be the next Eminem, he has to be either a crazy or lunatic, then you know, he's just gonna have to be off the wall. So I'm doing all these crazy like gangster, crazy, heavy, thugged out tracks, and I was using Reason at the time and making
And you've not
beats.
Met him yet. You're
not
making
met him.
This
Haven't
in
met
advance.
Him.
Yeah.
I go to New York and I'm in Avatar Studios just waiting for this guy. And here comes this Hasidic Jewish guy. He's like, oh, hello. And I go, hey man, are you lost? And I literally just tell him, you're looking for somebody. I was like, yes, I'm here. He's like, Ill Factor. No, I thought he was delivering a meal or delivering something. Like, oh yeah, that's me. What's up? What are you?
Crazy.
He's like, no, I'm Modest Yahoo. I'm like, what? I was like, are you serious? I'm like, yeah. I was like, well, man, none of my beats are kosher. Like, and like, I don't know what we're gonna. So I literally wiped everything that I was doing. But it was so cool because right from that, I was like, okay, like, and that has a lot to say with expectations and like reality and like what I was expecting and then what really turns out. And that's pretty much that sums up my whole music
Has
career.
Has that been a lesson that you've taken forward? Has that occurred to you again where you've just had these
throughout
expectations?
Throughout everything. Yeah. And I'm usually telling that to a lot of up and coming producers is that we tend to have this huge expectation of what even it might look like to succeed in music. Just because we have, you know, we have access to so much information and so many tools that, you know, 15 years ago we didn't have access to, or when I started producing music, I couldn't jump on YouTube to discover how to use this device or what seven things to do to you know, seven pitfalls to avoid when, there was none of that. It was just like school of hard knocks.
Yeah.
So now what's starting to happen is people would expect, oh, I've got all these things, or I've got all these plugins, I have all access to all these things. So what tends to happen is, I expect to be nominated for a Grammy next year. Okay, so we have this expectation all the way over here. What's reality? I just started making beats yesterday. Okay, so the distance between expectation and reality are pretty wide, so that means there's much more room for disappointment there.
Yeah.
So what I always kind of like tell people is like, oh, bridge that gap a little bit closer. Let the expectation be a little closer to what reality is.
And so to frame that though, you're talking about within Beat Academy when you're mentoring students and working with people coming up.
Or just a lot of people that I come across who might want to like, hey man, can you help me here? This is, you know, this is where I want to go. This is the next step I want to take with my music. And that is the underlying heart behind me wanting to create a platform like Beat Academy that allows me to not just create a cold refrigerator of courses, but a mentorship opportunity where I can come alongside people and help them take their next step with their music.
Did you have a mentor?
Like, yeah, I
coming
did.
Up? You did? Yeah.
I did.
Yeah.
So right from the get-go, and that's the thing. I was really blessed to be surrounded with so many people who had so many years behind them in this. One in particular was Jimmy Douglas.
Wow.
You know, world-renowned legendary mixing engineer, was there for back in the Atlantic Records days. So he was there with Tom Dowd.
Yeah.
For those who aren't familiar, Tom, you know, part of the Manhattan Project. He was part of like the Ray Charles, the old Atlantic record movement. Jimmy was a part of that. Then, you know, discovering Missy Elliott, Timberland, Genuine, and that whole crew. So, you know, linking up with him, having him mentor me and just kind of guide me through that whole process was really cool.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
And so now, you know, you have this refrigerator, like you said, like of lessons set up. If you could go back to your 18-year-old self or 20-year-old self, what would be the advice you would give that? Yeah. Besides the expectations part.
What would get a Beat Academy membership? No. what I would, you know, that's something I thought of. Like, what would I tell my 18-year-old self? I don't know, because there's so many things that I've learned. There's all the mistakes made to get to where I'm at today, mm-hmm. there is a lot of vital lessons learned from that. I think one of the biggest ones is the way I treated people. I treated mm-hmm. a people like a stepping stool to get to where I wanted to go to, as opposed to like a person. And that's one thing I would guard my 18-year-old self. It's like, look, dude, guard your heart from this mm-hmm. mindset of treating people like, you know, as some as a means to get to where you want. And
yeah.
Because that's what was happening to me, and I just thought that was a normal part of the music industry, and that's just mm-hmm. how the game is. And it's like, that's how it is. But yeah, I think that's what I would
like. You
more
thought of
more
it,
the mindset thing.
Like, there's a zero-sum game, right?
Right,
like
if
you are succeeding, then I'm not succeeding. So it was like that kind of action.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. The environment I was brought up in, and being born and raised here in Miami, and even mm-hmm. working in the Miami music scene here, like even working with some of the early guys, like with Jim Johnson, the Trick Daddy, like getting into like the hip hop scene.
Yeah.
And starting off in an electronic scene. So I started off DJing here in Miami, even back in the old Ultra Music Festival when they used to be on the beach and people were swimming over the fence to get in.
Nice.
I say that so like to authenticate. Oh yeah, that was the first earlier Ultra Music Festivals.
Yeah.
But yeah, I was DJing a lot of drum and bass in jungle. Mm-hmm. I was even performing at one of these festivals. And so seeing it evolve to where like throughout those years, you know, I wouldn't not do those mistakes. Like, I would probably just say, hey man, just keep doing it, but then just shift the mindset of like, don't take things personal,
mm-hmm.
you know? It's music.
Yeah.
You know, it's gonna affect people completely different.
It made you who you are, so yeah, it's not all negative.
Yeah, right? I probably would tell my 18-year-old self, bro, don't take it personal.
Yeah, cool.
I think that's the one thing I can sum it all up.
Are you listening to anything now that's kind of inspiring you, that's, like, where do you pull inspiration from musically these days?
Okay. It's usually when I'm cleaning the house. No,
yeah.
I'll put on some Celtic music. No, I don't.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Yes, I do.
Yeah. Elevator, walk by.
Actually, man, I've kind of been, I'll zone out with like some film score stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I do that just to kind of, so I'm listening to a lot of like, whether it's like Hans Zimmer stuff in the background, or guys like bands like Hammock,
mm-hmm.
who do these really cool ambient stuff. I really kind of like to zone out in a more less rhythmic environment.
Ambience. Does that make its way into your
sounds? It does, because there's a lot of emotion that's being carried mm-hmm. off in those textures and those in that palette, right?
Yeah.
So guys like Hammock, M83. You know, and then there's just some good classic rock stuff. You know, I'm still locked into my 1991, 95 bracket of.
We all are.
Yeah.
Like, so, it's what you grew up with is, you know, a reference to you and will always be. Yeah.
So Hammock, and then you got a Foo Fighter record, and then you go into like the Prodigy, Chemical Brothers, and then it's back to Massive Attack, and then some more ambient stuff, and throw a little John Williams in there. So it's a little of a mess. But yeah, that's
nice.
I kind of just will detach.
And for the scoring that you do, right? Like, you did a mnemonic recently, right? For Ubisoft.
Yes.
Yeah. And so, have you done a lot of mnemonics? Was that a new thing for you to do? What was that experience like?
Hardest thing I've ever had to do in my life.
Mm-hmm.
The audio identity brand, the little swoosh for that logo was, it was the hardest thing. I'll tell you why. Because they hit me up with a 25-page PDF report of like...
For 3 seconds of music.
For 2.8 seconds of music.
Of sound. It's not music. It's sound.
It's just sound. They're like, this is what we want the sound to look like. All right. Or to sound like.
Yeah.
I was like, sure, man. Like, what's a reference? Bam. Here's this PDF. Yo, this is 25 pages, son.
Yeah.
Like, this is a lot. This is like... Yeah. We want it to be moody, but yet new. Transcendent, but yet familiar. And I'm like... I don't even know what to do with this. So page two, I just, thank you. So if you guys are watching, it's okay. Yeah. We got the job done already. So,
it's out there.
Right. So page two, I was like, all right, let me just not read this. And let me just kind of look at this thing over and over and just see what feels I get from it. And and just started there. And I did like 7 submissions for it. And then there was like about 6 people also submitting for this too. So there was a whole thing with that. And I've done work with them on some other stuff with Assassin's Creed and the crew. And so they were like, hey bro, if you want to they didn't say it like that. They're French, so they're like, "Hey, bro, what's up?" They're like, "If you want to take a crack at this, go for it." I'm like, "Oh, sure, why not? What's not to lose?" So I ended up getting it. So that was really, really cool.
Nice. Yeah, that's cool. That stuff lives on forever too.
Yeah.
You know, like just people will always hear it, and it's just
it is universal. Really, really neat. Mm-hmm. So seeing it at like the E3 and then just like splash on the screen, I was like, "Oh yeah, that took me that was a lot of recall." Like that's when I see it, I'm like, finally, we're here.
After 26 pages.
Yeah, after 26 pages. So it's been cool.
So right now, I mean, I want to hear more about Beat Academy.
Okay.
Like, so you mentor people individually, you work with them as artists, you help them develop.
Yeah, so this spawned out of, so again, I'm in a new season of my life now.
Okay.
I've been producing music for a living for almost 20 years, it's like 19 and change there, but and that's looked differently throughout all those years. And now I'm at a point where I've just really been passionate about helping music producers and artists take their next step with their music. Mm-hmm. And that looks like on this platform, providing resources such as courses. So there's courses in which I walk through them all, songwriting and arranging, mixing, mastering, you know, even the insides of the music business, how to strategically navigate through this crazy music business and actually be successful with your music. So all that's in there with the courses, but then there's a community aspect where we're holding you accountable. So there's musicians and producers all over the world that are coming together through this platform that in which I'm like, hey, every month let's put a song together. Here's what you're gonna be getting for that. And then myself, there's coaching calls that I do too. So twice a month I'll do a call or I'll get feedback from some of the music that they submit. Mm-hmm. Hey, this is where you might wanna think about adjusting this, changing the melody here. And then I also have people from the industry, guys like Jimmy Douglas, Danger Hands, you know, managers, producers, artists themselves,
amazing,
jump on and just do answer some questions and stuff like that. So what I wanted to do was for that person in their bedroom, really passionate about taking their music and knows like, man, there's only so far I can get on my own. I need some mentoring. That's why I created Beat Academy for that, for that to happen.
Sounds amazing. I want to join.
For 5 easy payments and 2 really hard ones, you too can. No, I'm kidding. It's a subscription base, but we brought it down where it's just an annual, just pay, it's just annual ticket,
nice.
And you go.
So I've seen these amazing videos you've done where there's song recreations, where you recreate a song from scratch. Right. And what I'm wondering is, first, how do you get into doing this? And then also, how are you so good at it that you actually get, you know, licensing issues where people think it's the original?
Yeah. Well, those are fun. So in providing content on YouTube, I was kind of just like the well was running dry. I'm like, I don't know what else to talk about or to, you know, and this is just my own hangups to me thinking like, I don't even know where to, like, what do people want or what to hear? And then this all happened when I heard the Childish Gambino, This Is America record.
Yeah.
And I was like, I know that snare. I know that snare drum really well, and I think that's a snare from my sample pack that I was in. Wasn't sure, but when I was combing through the snare, I recreated the beat, and I was like, why not I'm just gonna recreate this, and then use this as a video, and that was the first one I put out, and then I was like, yo, that's dope. It's like, okay, I found it, and it's a good way for me to stay relevant. So what I'll do is I'll just check the charts, like what's charting, what's at the top 5. And I'll just recreate that because it just stays relevant. And then when people are searching for it at that time, it will also work with the algorithm being searched there. So there was just a cool strategic plan with that. And then doing it, my process is I'll just listen to it and actually might even import the reference track in there. Just take it, break it piece by piece, verse, a chorus. I would like to go, you know, for my own sanity and for time's sake, a lot of people are like, well, can you arrange the whole thing? I was like, well, I'll just get to the heart of it. You can kind of get the gist of where this needs to go. And I don't want to go too much into the arrangement of the track, but I want to get more focused into like how some of the sounds were created. I don't know, man, I've kind of been blessed with a good ear to I visualize it. So one of the things that have been helpful for me in trying to get to a sound that you're looking for is literally write out the visualization of that. If this sound, what texture do you see? Or okay, that sound, I hear metal clashing against some chains or something like that. Okay, And for me, that being able to visualize a sound can really help get to, I know I need to use a sawtooth, or I need to use this, or this plugin, or this particular sound to start with.
Do you have your students do it as well? Have you had them do recreations? Because it's got to be a great learning tool, right?
Yeah. Well, one of the most helpful things in music production in general to help, I do this with a lot of my Beat Academy students, I talk about this in my courses too, is having a reference. I mean, it's such a huge part. I think it's one of the most essential elements to getting better at producing music, is importing a reference track. And what I mean by that is, pick a song that narrows in close to like the genre that you're looking for, or more or less the sound that you're trying to go for. So if you're a hip hop artist, producer, and you're like, you know, I'd like to bring in, you know, maybe a J. Cole record, because I'm in that lane. So import a J. Cole record into the actual DAW. Not playing it on iTunes or on your phone and then going back. Bring it in there and then chop it up, verse, chorus, pre-chorus, and chop them up, and then loop each section and just get familiar. What is being added on the pre-chorus that is not being heard in the verse? What is being added in the chorus section that's not being heard in the pre-chorus? Get your mind familiar with those type of transitions so that you become, songwriting and arranging becomes second nature. Because what I get a lot is people saying, yo, I got a dope 4-bar loop, but I don't know how to write a song around that. Or how do I go from a 4-bar loop to a finished song? And the key there is a reference track. Because then you can roadmap everything. You see it. Now, then I get a pushback. Well, won't I sound exactly like that? No, you won't. It's just naturally going to happen. You use that as a guide. So it's the same thing as telling somebody, isn't it cheating using a compass to navigate through the woods? Like, no, you need that compass to help you navigate to where you want to go. And that's what a reference track is. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. It's like you're giving them the song form.
Right.
You're like, yeah, you've got 4 bars, but then you need to flush out all these other ideas. You know, the ideas are there, right?
And even sound selection too. It's like my snare doesn't pop as well as that one. What's that? And what's the balance between the vocals and their vocals and where I'm at? So it's always good to have it in there and reference.
So speaking of that, let's say you get a job. You know, you got to write something for Ubisoft. Let's say for a game. You've got your, you know, this is what they want, this is how long they want it to be, you know, this is, like, you've got the details, you know, it's about someone fighting, whatever. How, like, where do you even start? How do you start down? How do you sit down at that white blank canvas? And how do you put down those first notes?
Yeah, it's different for each scenario. So I'll give you, like, 3 scenarios, right?
Great.
There's producing music for sync, video game, film, and then there's producing music for an artist. And then there's maybe even like remixing or something like that.
Yeah.
So for the film and sync world, I draw a lot on the references there. And I do with all 3, but particularly that. So if the blank canvas is like, here's a cue, and that just means like, here's a footage from the game. They usually will come with, here's what we're kind of looking for. We're aiming for this type of vibe, but you have total creative freedom. I need the references to kind of give me some guardrails before I just go fully like Aphex Twin on it and just like, oh, here I recorded a squirrel, you know, bathing itself outside. And I put it in, I was like, what is this?
Yeah.
So I just want to get like, A, check out the footage. How do I vibe with it? Like just even with no music, it's like, oh man, this would be cool to go here. And then I would just draw something up really quickly, send that reference to, and it's always good to develop great relationships. Because if it was just cold turkey, I would never send a quick reference to them. I would work on it completely.
Because the mix isn't there, it's going to be rough.
Right. But because I'm a good rapport with the middleman, I'd be like, yo, what do you think of this vibe? Oh, it's cool. I love where you're going. Great. Then I can invest more time and energy there. But if you don't have that kind of relationship, then use a reference. Get it to match that as best as possible. Get it sounding great, polished, and then go ahead and present that. So that's how I would go about that. Working with the songwriter for an artist or working with an artist himself, that is completely more relational based. And that is where I might sit with a songwriter or an artist and we might even just talk about life for about 20 to 30 minutes. So we won't even like start with that. And I always kind of like that environment because when I'm working by myself and I'm tinkering around with patches or coming up with chord progressions, it's like I'm always second guessing myself. Like, it's the same chord progressions or same patches. It's hard to kind of spark inspiration for myself. But somebody in the room with me will hear that chord progression that I normally play, or that sample, or that sound, which I've heard 10,000 times, but to them, they're hearing it for the first time. It's like, oh, what is that? I'm like, oh, you like it? Oh, cool, cool. Yeah, and I'll use that. I'm like, okay. And I start hitting the ground running with that. So for me, that's kind of cool.
They start giving you direction. They start focusing.
Yeah, and I vibe off of that energy mm-hmm. that yeah. someone's feeding with me. For them, that one snare drum is like, or that one riff is super cool. I'm like, yo, what is that? And I'm like,
but do you lay down a beat? Do you go yeah. straight to playing keys?
So like, normally I would either brow suit some patches, mm-hmm. Some chord progressions, mm-hmm. and or just kind of play off a riff. Mm-hmm. Just, and this is after like digging in.
Yeah.
I'm like, yo, you know, yesterday I had an issue or something, and then I'll start playing. And then I'll start singing some melodies, and they're like, oh, that's cool. And then we kind of go off of there.
So why chords? I mean, why even start with chords? Why not a riff? Why not just like drum beats? What is it about chords for you that works in terms of sparking ideas with singers?
I would say, and sometimes it starts with a beat, sometimes mm-hmm. it's a riff, chord progressions. When I start navigating with chord progressions, I feel like it gives me, it already lays out the palette of colors that I can choose to paint with mm-hmm. for song-wise, right? Because the chord progression would immediately tell me what mood I'm in. Like, you know,
if and I start, are you thinking like scale? Is it like, okay, I'm in,
I don't even get that deep.
It's just these chords starting, on your
yeah, head. I'll start playing mm-hmm. and then I'll go to, you know, if G major chord, and then I start going to like the fifth, or you know, I'll just start experimenting, or even go to chords that are like, whoa, what am I playing right now? Like, I don't even know. Let me look at my fingers and then mm-hmm. like, and just see, because it's all in the feeling mm-hmm. for me. And for a lot of people that I work alongside too, it's like, oh, this feels so dope when I go from this to that. Mm. And that already kind of, that starts to bring up certain colors that we can use to draw out the story or draw out the overall message that we're trying to get across with the song. So, I mean, chords tend to do that when I start with the
chords. Do you then reverse, you know, do you go, oh, it turns out I'm in Dorian now. Like, do you reverse engineer it later, or do you just not even, you don't care, just these are my chords. The songs have these chords, it is what it is.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. So for me, personally, it's been like, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And like, yo, this works. And then with the little theory that I have, mm-hmm. you know, being brought up, learning piano and even playing trombone and just being trained in that and in mm-hmm. music theory, I can do that and I can navigate to, okay, we need to, this is not going to work for you. Let's transpose this. Let's go down. Mm-hmm. But I don't want to be hung up on the technical aspect of like, well, we're in Dorian. We need to switch this up, because then mm-hmm. I'm losing at the very core what's important to me and the artist, which is like that feels right. Right. Whatever you're doing, that feels right. Go for keep going with that.
So the feeling's the compass.
Yeah.
On the chords.
Yeah. But we have to be careful, because then sometimes it's tricky, because then sometimes mm-hmm. you're just not feeling it. And it doesn't mean that you shouldn't put work or effort to power through that to get to where you need to go to.
Yeah.
So it's a little weird, because then you're like, oh, we're not feeling it, so drop it. And no, sometimes you just gotta like, yeah, I'm not feeling it, so let's just work at it, tinker and move things around. Mm-hmm. And I was like, okay, now you've kind of put the Rubik's Cube together.
Find the feeling.
Yeah, yeah. Because you can't, your feelings are not absolute. You can't use that also as the plumb line. It can't really be based off feelings as well. But it's a good place, it's a good starting point.
So what about when you're writing a track for an artist, but you're not with the artist in the room? How do you even approach that?
All right, that's a good question. I tend to see that when I'm trying to write for someone, it just never works out. It just never works. Hey, mm-hmm. Rihanna needs another single for a new album. Great, mm-hmm. I don't do well in writing camps. Mm-hmm. Or in particularly in the situation where it's like, we need to write for this artist, we need to write for, you know, for Selena Gomez, or put this mm-hmm. together for her. My mind just like locks up, and I'm like, oh, I don't know, let me listen to her previous stuff. And that's what we all tend to do. Let's listen to her last stuff. Let's see what's the vibe. Let's mm-hmm. see what we, no. It always ends up hurting me creatively. So what I've just done is, okay, that's nice for them. I'm just gonna write stuff that I would resonate with to begin with. Because mm-hmm. if I resonate, and if I'm vibing with what I'm doing, mm-hmm. and I'm like, oh, this is so dope, it's gonna work for an artist. It's going to find its home better than me trying to force my hand creatively for a creative. Now, what works is if I'm in the room with that artist, that's a whole other picture, because then we can just vibe and go back to that scenario I mentioned earlier. And a lot of, I prefer that.
So in that scenario, you write for almost yourself.
Right.
Yeah.
And usually I'll be with a songwriter or someone who can kind of convey a message, or, and usually that songwriter is like, you know, and we would say, instead of like, instead of you fixing your attention on what would Selena Gomez sing or write with, just like, what are you going through? Like you, songwriter, like, what is it that you're going through? Because your emotion is going to be carried much more into the song than trying to fake it for somebody else. And those are usually the songs that land really well, right?
And that's what they're looking for.
Right.
A song that's sincere and has message from someone else. Yeah.
Yeah.
Tell me five techniques for music production in 2020 that you think are vital right now.
Sidechain.
No, without sidechain. Sidechain's not in there. New, what are the top five techniques for 2020 that are vital to any music producer right now?
Okay, wow. Okay, I'm going to start with some of the technical and then work way to like even strategical, you know, with even building like an audience and things, because I think it plays a little well. Technically, I think we're on the tail end of vocal chopping. I think vocal chop stuff was like very 18 and 2019 stuff. So I think it's always going to move with what we're seeing a lot now is stereo wobble or plugins like that are causing a lot more lo-fi. You know, we're seeing a lot more lo-fi. People gravitate to lo-fi, so they'll take a riff, they'll take a piano, they'll take a basic simple sound or patch, and then go ahead and create stereo width by whether it's a Haas effect. And what I mean by that is just taking some delay and slightly having the left and the right time differently. And so any way to create some lo-fi response to any of your plugins or any of your patches is kind of what we're seeing. We're seeing a lot of that in trap and a lot of the hip hop. And a lot of the hip hop will start off with a riff, but then it's just like wobbled or gargled out as lo-fi. So that's the thing. Mm-hmm. Now, I think these things play off of the trends, right? They play off of like what's really being circulated now on radio and things like that. So that's why I went with that one. Number two is just like 808 saturation. So running some 808 samples through some amp simulators or some fuzz distortions, nothing new, but it's just becoming more and more evident. So crossing that over with pop production, right? So not necessarily just having a distorted 808 and trap, but maybe having a distorted 808 carry on to like just regular pop production and using that in there as well. It helped the 808 cut through the mix a lot and just adds a lot more low-end beef to it as well. And then, one thing I like using too is having other tracks gate other tracks. So having my drums trigger a pad with a gate on it. So let me just break that down. You might have a pad or a track with strings or something like that playing a chord progression. And then if you put a gate, now the gate is a plugin that won't, that'll allow audio to be heard once it passes a certain threshold. And so gates are a great plugin to have even now, like as we're talking, we don't want any background noise. Mm-hmm. We can put a gate in our vocal and then just raise the threshold so that once our vocal passes that line, we get to hear the vocal. So when you put a gate on a pad, and then you could sidechain, there you go.
You sidechain the gate.
You sidechain the gate.
Instead of a compressor.
Yeah, right. Cool. Sidechain the gate to like the drums or something like that.
Nice.
You can have the pads now move in the rhythm of the drums, and now you're creating a really cool rhythm with the pads.
So nice.
That's cool. Nice. Where are we at? Like four, three?
We're one again. No, we're three.
Three.
Yeah.
I don't know, man. I'm trying to think. I'm trying to go back to like the recreations I've done, right? Mm-hmm. Like what's happening. There's a lot of.
What's another technique? Like sidechaining a gate, I think, is fascinating. That's good. That's a great idea. Like you put the release on the gate as well, so that it can hold, like you time it, I would imagine. Yeah. You can even mute the original.
Yeah, like you can mute the original source. Another thing too is like doing a lot of vocal stuff. So you could take the lead vocal track, you can duplicate that track, and then you could pitch that down, 12 semitones down. And when it's being pitched down, you could layer that with the lead vocal to add just like that low octave vocal to beef it up. You see a lot of this happen in the Billie Eilish stuff. She'll take her lead and Finesse will just duplicate her vocal and have like an octave higher, and then you have an octave lower vocal, and then you can kind of do some really cool stuff like that and pan one to the left, pan one to the right, and do a lot of cool vocal manipulation too. So when it comes to like, why is someone like Billie Eilish like really popular right now and surging? There's always a cycle of a Billie Eilish artist that just surges out and is like polarizing, like, wow, that's amazing. So there's a lot unpacked there. A, herself as an artist, you know, a demographic, like what is she standing behind? It's like, hey, I'm not wearing any scandalous clothes. It's like, this is who I am. So there's a lot that a generation can resonate with that with. And then there's a unique style approach, right? The way she's doing a lot of vocal delivery, very soft. And so when you have a lot of artists that are maybe a lot more stronger in their delivery. So for instance, you're look at the contrast with the soft vocal over an 808 harsh beat. The contrast there, there's so much contrast, it's alluring and it's a very attractive. So when I hear like a beat, maybe even something like Bad Guy or that, and that's what I'm saying. So you have like this hard production or this really cool production, and then you have a very soft, almost angelic, mysterious, enigmatic voice on top of it. It's a cool package. And then you throw her and her persona on there. And so it's this whole perfect storm that brews.
Sounds to me like you're kind of calling her an outlier, right? Like she's this exception to the rule, in a way, of the artist.
Yeah, like, and the thing is, you know what? Goes right back to what I was saying earlier about this feeling. Mm-hmm. So you've got this whole bedroom producer vibe that everybody's like chiming in on. Oh, they did the record in the bedroom. Yeah, and that's great. And that's a great flag to wave, and that's a great banner to hold down and plant. What's cool about that is that they really would just focus on, we're just doing what we love doing.
Yeah.
And it just caught on like wildfire. But it wasn't like, hey, how do we formulate how do we strategically make you a superstar?
They never thought that ever.
Never.
And it goes back to what you were saying about how you write songs, which is they're focused on the feeling. They're focused on being themselves. You, when you're writing for an artist, you're focused on, well, I just want to do what I think is my best self that I'm going to get to them. And then hopefully they resonate with it. You know, it's the same thing.
Yeah, because there was this bracket of time in my career where I was chasing the, hey, so-and-so needs this record or so-and-so needs to do this. And I would be like, hey, what would be a great beat or great song for this artist? And I would just hit the wall every time. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't until I had someone in the room and we're just vibing that those songs end up landing where I was like, there's a common denominator here. Every song that I try to prep, maybe one got through, it was just like, you know, there's a lot of things that had to happen to get that through. But the majority was just like, you know, this just kind of fell in its place really naturally.
In a weird way, I'd say Billie Eilish reminds me of like the White Stripes, Jack White scenario.
Yes.
Because it was just this pop sensation, but it was the most sincere, you know, it's music on its own that came out. Right?
Exactly. So look at that. That was a cycle. Yeah. The White Stripes came up, blew up, and then it just goes in. Not to say they're not, but that's that cycle where
they both did James Bond themes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
That's pretty nuts. But look at it like where we're at right now, how are we consuming music? And the platform in which we're consuming music is really gonna dictate how we're discovering artists and how we're navigating through that. So right now, like TikTok or these kind of platforms are kind of like deliberately pointing to how music is being discovered and surged. So if you look at like what's being virally trending, it's songs that are like, you know, okay, boomer, or I've got my, I slammed my fingernail on the bus. And I was like, what is this? But it's because it's benefiting the content that's being created on this platform. Like kids are just filming themselves, lighting themselves on fire or whatever, and they need a song that goes well with that.
Yeah.
And then automatically that song just got placed on there, and that's why that's a surging. So, you know, guys like Lil Nas X and things like that, Old Town Road, it's a great example of how this is helping so many people navigate through being discovered and being planted on that, so.
I think the beauty of it too is that you've got so much available to you. Let's just say you have Logic or Ableton, just the basic one. you don't need any plugins. Maybe you need Captain plugins if you don't know music theory. But besides that, you have so much in terms of production available to you. Like, you can make a Billie Eilish record in your bedroom.
Yeah.
You know, the White Stripes needed a studio with, you know, reel-to-reel tape to record and all this other stuff. You know, the production level, the denominator got so low now that it's accessible to everybody, you know?
Yeah, it truly is amazing what can be done with a simple laptop or even your phone, for crying out loud. You know, like, it's amazing what can be done with just the least amount and just the drive and the creativity to want to do it.
Yeah. And do you think it's harder that it's so accessible now, or do you think it's easier? What do you think is, what's your point of view on that?
I think there's two ends of that spectrum. So there's paralysis by analysis. Mm-hmm. There's so much information. There's so much, like, I don't teach anything new on YouTube, or I'm not sharing anything new. It's all there. You could find it. It's nothing new. I just have a new, unique perspective and experience of the way I deliver it. But you could be overwhelmed with all the stuff that's out there, or you could just be, you know, and the great thing about that is, wow, there's so much out there. I mean, you know, I have so much to choose from. So, yeah, I think the balance is kind of knowing what you want to strive for. So, like, even on a practical level, like, this week I want to make, like, 5 beats, okay? And I want to make 5 beats using this plugin, this sound, right? Or this type of beat. And then, like, using the other side, like, what information can I grab? What tools can I grab to help me acquire accomplishing that goal this week? So if you start navigating it that way, it can work really well for you.
With this world of plugins that everybody has at their fingertips, just that comes with the DAW, what do you think is the essentials that someone needs to learn to be able to make great music right now?
That's a great question, because, like, currently the state that DAWs are in, whether it's Fruity Loops, Logic, Ableton, even Pro Tools, there's just so much there. And I think what's happening is there is this mindset to believe that, well, what's that person using? That's the plugin I need in order for it to be well, or in order for my song to finally sound polished or ready. So I always encourage that if you can master what you already have, you'll be able to reflect that mastery on, if you learn the stock compressor, especially on Logic or in Ableton, you're gonna learn every other compressor in the world, because they all are doing the same thing. So I think the essentials are, like, in basic 3 categories. You have your tone shaping category. So that's master EQs, right? EQs, filters, things that can shape the tone. Like, learn them. Learn how they work and manipulate them. Then you have your dynamic category. Learn what compression does. Gates, expander, all those things, right? And then the third one would be synthesis, where you basically don't have to be a crazy, you know, person patching all this stuff there, but you have to, if you familiarize yourself with, like I call them, the basic food groups of synthesizer, like, know what these things sound like, and that's important. Not like, you don't have to know every single button on every synth plugin, but if you can get familiar with, hey, a sawtooth is a very bright tone, a sine wave is a very dull tone, and then everything in between is somewhat of a little bit of both. So, you know, that's gonna be really helpful for you to develop the ear trainer to be like, well, I want that big anthemic synth type of sound. Well, I'm gonna go with a sawtooth and then learn the workings of how to shape that. So if you can master those tools, you've basically have set yourself up to know how to navigate through any other plugin that you would invest.
As a music producer, what's the edge that you get knowing some music theory?
That's a good question. I've worked with numerous music producers, really big name producers, who just wouldn't care the difference between a major and minor chord. And they navigate more off the feeling that they're getting when production. And you know what? At the end of the day, the person on the other side of the laptop doesn't really care about what that. But the edge that you have is almost like the ability to learn how to learn. So let me frame it like this. It's kind of the difference between punching in an address in a Google Maps and it having it take you there, to knowing the tools and how to read a map. so that you can actually end up anywhere and know how to navigate where you want to go. So if you does that make sense?
Total sense.
So yeah. If you can look at that and say, yes, technology allows me to download loops and riffs on whatever it is on website and not even have to dabble with music theory, yeah, that's fine. And if you can not put it all together, if you can punch that into Google Maps and end somewhere special, great. But if you know the tools, if you know how to read the compass, if you know how to actually gauge a map and be like, you know what, this is, and it makes it much easier for me working with other people. When they have something they want to express, I can help navigate to where we want to go with a little bit of theory.
I always think of it like reading, right? Let's say you cannot read, but you have to give speeches. It's so much harder because you have to memorize it all. You know, the ability to read music means that you can just look at sheet music and pull it in and you can express it.
Yeah.
Now, with composition, you have, you know, we're with Captain Chords here, mixed in key.
Yeah.
How does that play in that you just have this resource of keys and scales and a composition plugin?
I think the Captain Chords plugins, and I'm not just saying this because I'm with you guys, I think what you guys have done well and the way the plugins are structured well is it really just clears the fog up of what to search for and what's going to be beneficial for the producer or the artist. For instance, if you just go online and say, okay, music theory, you're going to, it's almost like brain surgery, like how do I do it, right? There's so much, it's so complex, they can get as deep as you want with music theory. But what's great about the way the plugins are structured is, here it is in a very simple way, what do you want, where do you want to go? Mm-hmm. I was like, okay, well, and what I, even me, like what I like using the plugin for would be like, okay, my hands normally gravitate to specific chord progressions. That's just because I'm always there. I'm like,
yeah,
I'll gravitate. So what would happen if I would just use a means that I'm not usually approaching? So let me start with Captain Chords. Let's start with this key. What does a 1-3-6 sound like in this key? It's like, okay, I normally don't go to a 1-3-6 here. And that's what's cool, is it really just demystifies a lot of that process. And it's not necessarily like forcing you to know music theory, but it really allows music theory to be a natural part of the process again without it being a stumbling block. Does that make sense?
Perfect. Yeah, I mean, it's what you were talking about before too, that palette. Like, it's a palette of theory.
Yeah.
These are chords that work into your palette.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I love like what's happening now where you can like, there's a lot of these meal deliveries. Right? Mm-hmm. Like these companies that send you these ingredients.
Yeah.
You don't know how to cook, no problem. We're gonna give you the same exact ingredients you need to make that amazing dish. It's like, but I've never cooked before in my life. It's okay, we literally give you every step, every ingredient. So I kind of look at it like that. Like, you might be a chef in the kitchen. You know what you wanna cook, but you just don't know, like, and you can grab things from the kitchen. It's like, all right, here's the basic, you know, I need chicken here, all this stuff here. But Captain is like, here, I'm gonna deliver every ingredient you're gonna need for this palette that works well together. That's the thing, because you can literally grab anything from the kitchen and throw it together. You can grab any notes, because technically you can just play, you can have a squirrel running on top of the keyboard and use that. But if you wanna have sensible combinations that make sense and that really locks in, like, hey, like, this is what a real good pop song, this is a chord progression that a pop song uses. Mm-hmm. There you go. So that's really helpful, especially for those who are diving into making their own music for the first time. Really, really helpful.
I think that's also the benefit of Captain Melody, because you could have these chord changes. You'll have set your palette, right? And then you can actually follow those chords melodically, which is something I think an advanced musician gets to.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I saw a video you made that kind of showed that. And it's an evolution to get to this point where you think, okay, I can target the third on this chord, and then I go to the one and it resolves this melody. And I think those are the tools that some musicians might have inherently. You know, someone's musical, they have a great sense of melody, but it's also something that you can nurture and develop the more you are aware of it.
Yeah, I agree. They're really helpful tools to understand the why of what's going on, right?
Yeah.
Because again, like the music theory enthusiast would be like, oh, let's just take the leading tone, resolve to the tonic, or let's go to the one. But mm-hmm. someone just having fun making music is like, leading what? And what are you trying to do? Mm-hmm. And so you might get pushbacks like, oh, well, that's cheating. You're not going through the hard work. I mean, granted, when you invest time and energy in understanding the why, you're going to grow deeper in that anyways. But it really takes away a lot of the frustration and disheartening of, well, I don't even know where to begin. And so it does that really well.
I mean, within Mixed and Key, within the people that work in it, there's plenty of people that have worked for these plugins that have music degrees. I have a music degree. Like, I don't consider it cheating that I'm pulling up something with scales and chords.
Yeah.
Because it's like you said, you know, okay, I know how to read a map, but I just put it into Google Maps. It's not cheating. It's just another way to use a tool, you know? And it's just another tool in my palette, right? And I think it also gets back to just trying to sound as much as like yourself as you want, you know, as you can. It's a tool to help you express yourself.
Yeah, it does a good job in unpacking. Like, I'm using it more as a creative tool, as opposed to as like a need for like, okay, I need to know what chords go well in this key.
Yeah, same here.
And so it's great for those who are like, look, I don't know what a key signature is, let alone know what notes belong in that key. So it's a great, I use it to actually teach music theory in my Beat Academy platform. So I use it as an actual tool. Here's a great way to navigate through knowing what notes belong in the chords and in the key. But for me, I'm like, all right, let me just randomly go to different progressions, and I don't normally go to those progressions. That's cool. And that's how I use it as a creative spark in my workflow currently.
So what do you think producers coming up, younger producers, have the most difficult time with?
That's a good question. It'll vary, but the common denominator, what I see most often, is not using a reference. Mm-hmm. I think that's the biggest mistake, because they're going off of what they believe is like, hey, this feels good, this is a cool little vibe. But when I use that, when I reference that to a current, when I raise that to my standard of what's a good hit song, it's like, well, these are all the elements that are missing. So I think one of the biggest things young producers aren't doing, I mean, they're caught up in the fun of it, which is great, just do that. Mm-hmm. But then start using a reference, an anchor point that you can pull from to be like, okay, what makes my song different to a chart-topping song right now? What am I missing there? And not connecting those dots. How do you overcome that? Well, I think just do that, right? Start using references in the track, then you can start to compare. And it's also helpful to be like, what chords are why does this feel like a great song? And what elements am I missing from mine? Like, what does the bass line do?
So analyzing the song.
Yes.
But not just musically, like structurally.
Yeah, structurally.
Yeah.
And I think that's the thing. A lot of structure is missing a lot in a lot of up-and-coming producers, because you're so caught in the hype and raptured in the, I made an 8-bar loop beat and this is so cool and look at all that. And then, you know, and that's fine. I was there too. I was there for a long time.
So it's thinking like a beat maker, but not thinking like a songwriter.
Right.
Right. Mm-hmm. That's a big challenge.
Yeah.
You're a songwriter, you're working at home, you're making beats. How do you then get let's say a singer involved if there's not a singer that you know or you already work with in your neighborhood?
Yeah, out of necessity, I've put my own vocals down on things. Even the song that was used on the Assassin's Creed trailer, that's me singing that. I sound like a dying yak, but that's the importance of knowing your tools, because if you can know them well, you can make anything sound good, right? There's great resources out there if you wanna do some collaborating. Particularly with vocalists and bring them alongside with what you're doing. A site that I recommend is soundbetter.com. It's a great resource, because there you can then find vocals that fit the style of music that you're doing, and everyone's particularly like, they have, hey, you know, I will do this. You know, it's not like a Fiverr. This is actually aimed specifically towards just vocalists or musicians. Hey, I would love to have a guitar player featured on this. I can go to Soundbetter and find one that really fits the vibe that I'm looking for, and then just communicate with them. Hey, like, here's a song. Could you work on it? Sure. Here's the fee, and then everything gets curated through the middleman, and it's done really well. And so, use Soundbetter, and it's been really cool.
Sounds great.
Yeah.
And it's collaborative. It's not hiring someone.
Right. It's collaborative.
That's good.
or either or. It could be collaborative, and you could just straight up say, "Hey, I want to hire you to play or sing on my project."
I notice a lot of artists have a hard time getting to the finish line with the track. Mm. You know, I personally have a bunch of tracks that are just half written, not completed. How do you take something to the end and release it? How do you craft that final mix?
For me personally, it was accountability. And what I mean by that is, A, invite somebody into that process. Because just as we've grown tired of hearing that riff or that sample or that snare drum that we might even have on our hard drive, when somebody hears it for the first time, they're like, whoa, that's cool. That's what we need in those times. Where we feel like we're just too afraid to release our own music, or we're just, you know, hey, timid, I don't know what everybody's gonna think of it. I don't know if it's ready yet. I think you need to start including accountability. And what that looks like practically is, you need to draw the line in the sand, like commit 5 months from now, I'm gonna release 3 songs. And I'm gonna invite somebody in that process, say, hey man, 5 months from now, I'm gonna release this. Can you hold me accountable? Can you like check up on me, see how we're doing? And as a matter of fact, I wanna work with you on this, right? And that tends to really put fire under some people's feet. Like, oh man, I really gotta get this thing done in 5 months or 3 weeks. But when there's somebody else in the picture too, it's like, okay, like, you know, this is not just all on me. So that's been a real helpful tool for me personally. I mean, I just released an EP with a good friend of mine, Graham Cochran, with that same mentality. I don't normally like, I have tons of stuff lying on the hard drive.
Yeah, of course.
But when you invite somebody in the process, you're like, I guess I gotta put this thing out now because I told this person I was gonna do it. So yeah, and that could look different for a lot of people, but I find that accountability is one of the greatest ways to kill the fear of not wanting to put your music out there. And you'll never know, like, you'd be surprised, because then that also, you're asking the why. Mm-hmm. Why am I making music in the first place? Yeah. Is this solely so that it can be like, well, if I'm making it because I want somebody to resonate with how I'm feeling and what my music is doing. I want it to impact. A lot of people tell me, I want my music to impact somebody. Well, do it, release it. Because you're only impacting the hard drive. A bunch of ones and zeros, they're jumping up and down.
Yeah.
But if the goal was to have your music impact somebody, then there should be no hang-ups in getting it out there. But if the goal is to be successful and make $1 million off of your music, then you need to, that, you see what I'm saying? That
yeah.
There's a different strategy for that. You need to get a fan. That's what I'm trying to get at. So accountability would be a great way to get over that.
Your daily, you know, what's your daily routine for getting in there and writing a track? Do you have a routine? Do you have a set time you
get started? I wish I was more disciplined with it, really. Lately, I've been doing a lot of stuff like for Beat Academy, but in the creative side of things, I start listening to music. I'll put up a Spotify playlist and I'll hit shuffle play or discover, just some kind of algorithm, just venture off in the wilderness. Stuff I don't normally listen to, just come across some new music and I'm like, oh, that's really cool. And then I go into that recreative state that I'm in, I'm like, oh, let me try to recreate that. Or let me just try to implement that. And then somehow, and it always works where I'm like, I'll try to recreate or do something, and then I end up like, oh, that's cool. And I just zone out and I'm coming up with something new.
So that's how you find your inspiration. You're listening, you hear a track and you say, I want to recreate something, I want to pull something from there.
Yeah.
And then that's a seed.
That's one aspect, but 80% of the time, I'm a very big, like, just give me a list to do and I'll do it. So a lot of times I reach out to accountability again. I'll reach out to good producer friends of mine from all over the world and say, hey, what's on your radar? And they'll be like, yo, I've got a session in with so-and-so next week. It's like, got it. And that to me, because then I have like a timeline, I've got like something I gotta do, some reference stuff. So that to me, I work great under that kind of pressure. So it's like, so when I'm like in a rut, I'll take a break or I won't do anything. But then when I'm in a rut, I'll just reach out and like, what's on your plate? Do you have anything? It's like, yo, yeah, I'm glad you reached out. I need this and this and this. Great. And it becomes like a task for me to do, and I get excited about it. For some people, they're like, ew, no, I just want to go with the flow. For me, that works really well.
So you need that timeline. You need a deadline.
Yeah.
Ill Factor, thank you so much for being here today.
Hey, my pleasure.
And so for our audience to find you, where should they look you up?
Yeah, definitely reach out at beatacademy.com, mm-hmm. beatacademy.com. And that's the best way to get a hold of me and to actually take advantage of a lot of the free resources that I have available right now.
Absolutely. Sounds good.
Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.